not win the title in that event, but shop for the most money.
Yes. Got the lion's share, made the deal with the most, and
I think you could say that he and Aaron both sort of won that event in that sense. Aaron got the title, but they chopped the money.
Yeah. Yeah, and someone in the chat asking if this is Limitless Online, I believe that's right, but I'm not positive.
Yes, I think so. Yeah, Victor Malinowski is indeed Limitless, as far as I'm aware.
Yep, I believe that's true.
Ben, Limp Jack 6, facing effectively a 4x. What do you think about getting out of line here? Does continue.
So Ben Heath calls in the small blind with Jack 6 of hearts. Limitless raises it 3.8x with 7s, and Ben calls. At 60 big blinds and with the ante, we see that the small blind's opening range is very broad, and checks and raises are spread throughout for balance. In Limitless's shoes, we see that all pocket pairs down to 7s are raising 100% of the time, and given how broad the big blind's merged raising range is, we see that the small blind is defending over 50%, including with basically all suited Broadway X combos.
What the cutoff is here, Jeff, with hands going to limp call if Jack 6 gets in it. Wow.
What a flop. Oh my goodness.
Wow, wow, wow. We're going the distance with this one, ladies and gentlemen. Ben, top pair, flush draw. Victor, very disguised set.
Super wet board. Going to probably go fairly big, but I guess you could go either way
right,
here. Super wet board.
Right, Ben's...
You're going small.
Eyes gone small. Like Ben's limp calling range just hits this quite a lot.
I guess that makes sense, too, to go small here, because he's going to do that with probably his whole range. And I mean, it's a wet board, but at the same time, if he just bets like 20,000, you know, it's like you're going to lose so many marginal hands.
The flop comes 9-7 jack with two hearts, giving Limitless mid-set and Ben top pair with a flush draw. Ben checks and Limitless continues with a small quarter pot bet. So although Limitless was the preflop aggressor here, assuming that he raised with a somewhat merged range similar to GTO, his range should actually be very wide and therefore quite weak. Additionally, Ben should have a number of nuttish holdings in his range on this board, including straights, sets, and two pairs. Accordingly, we see that the solver is mostly checking in this spot, and when it does bet, it prefers a smaller sizing. However, we see that mid-set is mostly betting since, obviously, this is a very strong hand that wants to begin building the pot, and the small blind should have a number of connections to this very wet board that can continue.
Is this small enough that Ben could even consider a raise here?
Mm-hmm.
He's never going to get three betters if he raises the flop. No, obviously quite happy to take a turn card with top pair and a flush draw, but...
Ben calls, and we see that the solver is mostly just calling here as well. If we filter by Ben's flush draws, we see that although certain other flush draws do raise, most flush draws plus top pair are simply calling, other than the stronger king-jack and queen-jack combos. In this spot, given how wide the big blind range is, Ben should be pretty content with shifting into bluff-catching slash equity realization mode with this holding that does not require much protection.
We're seeing spots pop up, Jeff, where both options are possible. Wow, a turn card that almost kills it.
Yeah. So you'd need a jack or a nine, or otherwise he's in big trouble. His flush draw shrinks the board pairs in his eyes, but he still probably feels decent with his hand here. Can't think that if his opponent has a boat, so he still... feels the hearts are good, and
right.
Jack is in the lead a lot. Interesting.
Wow.
The turn is the 9 of diamonds, completing Limitless's full house, and he decides to check. And we see that the solver is indeed checking this holding around 32% of the time. So why is this? Well, the GTO check blueprint, which we've discussed in prior videos, uses a three-step heuristic to help determine whether a hand should be slow played from a GTO perspective. As is always the case, the first step is to analyze the overall strategy of Hero's range, since generally speaking, there will often be a rough correlation between the amount of checking the range is doing overall and the amount of trapping the solver tends to do. In this case, although the big blind is the preflop aggressor and he's in position, his range is extremely wide and this turn is not very favorable for him. Right, if we run out all possible turn cards, we see that the turns where the solver is checking with greatest frequency are turns where straights complete and turns where the 7 or 9 pairs. Turns that pair under cards, in particular, are usually unfavorable for a preflop aggressor that c-bet on the flop because much of the caller's continuing range will be comprised of underpairs, whereas many of the aggressor's underpairs will often prefer to check on the flop. Accordingly, we see that the big blind's checking frequency has increased to around 60%. And from a GTO standpoint, this means that we'll generally want to include some traps to protect our checking line. So after we've determined that we should be doing some amount of slow playing in this spot, the next step is to move on to the meso analysis to gauge the relative strength of hero's hand class versus villain's range. Generally, the class of hands that serve as ideal slow play candidates are nuttish holdings that do not require much protection. Obviously, a full house is clearly a nuttish holding in any scenario, but it is particularly strong here because the small blind's range is very wide, since we're blind versus blind and limitless bet small on the flop. Right, Ben should have many very weak combos that will fold to a bet, but may bluff versus a check, and or that may hit a stronger hand on the river, particularly on this extremely wet board. So finally, we move on to the last step, the microanalysis, to consider which nuttish hands have the best slow playing micro attributes. Specifically, the solver will have a tendency to slow play combos that block villain's continuing range and or that unblock the weaker portion of villain's range. And the solver will tend to not slow play combos that unblock villain's continuing range and or that block the weaker portion of villain's range. For example, we see that the big blind's kings and aces are mostly checking, likely at least in part due to the fact that they heavily block the numerous weak ace-x and king-x combos in Ben's range, whereas queens are being bet nearly 100% of the time, despite being lower in equity. And on the flip side, we see that the one nuttish segment that is not being slow played at all are the straights, likely because they totally unblock the pairs and trips in Ben's range that should be able to continue to a bet, and at the same time, straights block the numerous weak gut shot draws in Ben's range that may have called on the flop, but would likely fold to another bet on the turn depending on the sizing. In terms of the big blind's other nuttish combos, we see that the solver is spreading its traps across segments among its quads, full houses, and trips. This specific spot is a bit unique given that we are blind versus blind and the board is very wet. So although a particular nuttish hand in Limitless's range may block certain segments of Ben's continuing range, there should be a significant number of other combos in Ben's range that can continue facing a bet. For example, in other scenarios, a full house with top set may be a primary slow playing candidate since it heavily blocks the top pairs in Ben's range. However, here we see that the solver is doing quite a bit of betting with jacks, which makes sense since even if we exclude top pair from Ben's range, he should have a number of flush draws, straights, and trips that will continue against most bets. Accordingly, other than with respect to the straights, kings, and aces as we discussed, the solver appears to be mostly indifferent in terms of which other nuttish combos it chooses to trap with, and therefore checks are allocated across most of these combos.
Gives him some rope here.
This pot could have been a lot bigger.
Actually, you know, if you're Ben, it's a good spot to bet for sure. You think, first of all, you probably have the best hand, and you miss hearts. The hearts, you don't block hearts, right? In your opponent's eyes, he probably doesn't have hearts. You have the hearts. It looks like maybe you missed. You could definitely get heroed here, right? When
right.
You have the two hearts. So, and you think you have the best hand. So, really, betting just makes so much sense.
You know, king, queen. Queen 10, King 10, all hands that would have carried on.
Mm-hmm.
The river is the deuce of spades, and Ben decides to fire a 60% pot bet, and this is consistent with the solver strategy with this holding that has over 80% equity in this spot. This is despite the fact that Ben's kicker is weak, and this board is quite dangerous with quads, full houses, straights, and trips in the big blind's range. But this highlights why the GTO check blueprint advocates resetting your analysis at each possible decision point. It's easy to get lost in the weeds when you're analyzing tricky spots and getting into the minutiae of identifying specific combos that might comprise villain's range. So it's important to take a step back and reassess things from a broader perspective at each decision point, especially since equities can shift dramatically from street to street. So from a macro perspective, in this case, although Limitless does have most of the nuttish hands in his range, given that his range is so wide and he checked on the turn, he should have an even greater percentage of weaker hands such as 7x, lower pocket pairs, and ace and king highs. And therefore, from a meso-analysis perspective, the likelihood of Limitless's specific holding being strong is low, which in turn elevates the strength of Ben's top pairs, which are betting almost 100% of the time with this sizing regardless of kicker. So although we can see the whole cards and know that Ben is hurtling himself into the wood chipper here, from a GTO standpoint, the probabilities dictate that Ben is likely ahead, justifying a healthy bet out of position.
You say some missed hearts. I'm just still kind of perplexed by that bet size from Victor on the flop. Just this kind of texture, you normally see people get bigger. But
it's a long hand.
Yeah, well, and it's going to go for a little bit longer because we know a raise is incoming.
What do you think? 70?
Ben's going to be in a real tough spot, right? I mean,
I think he's going to go 73. In that range, he's gonna make
3X.
It, yeah, make it kind of affordable. I mean, this hand couldn't have run out any better of a board, other than I guess a heart on the river.
At the same time, what strong hands does Victor have here? There aren't many. I mean, Ben blocks jacks. It's 2 9s on the board.
Interesting, really. Yeah, sizing is going to be curious.
I think you can just
here.
Go. It's one. Because I don't think Ben would expect him to bet so small on the flop with such a strong hand, right? I don't think Ben thinks Victor has many.
Time bank card's sick too. I think, you know, if you're Ben, you're thinking about hero calling, and then you're going to see a raise.
All in.
Yeah, I was going to say the overbet is a sick line because he doesn't really have strong hands here.
Limitless shoves, nearly 3xing the pot and 9xing Ben's bet. However, we see that although the solver obviously raises with this holding, it strongly prefers a 2/3 pot raise over a shove, and it isn't really shoving at all in this spot. One of the possible reasons for this is due to the limited number of natural bluffs in Limitless's range on this board given the prior action. Right, overbets tend to be used more often by the solver when Hero has a significant number of both strong value combos and bluffs in his range, which is not the case here. There are no flushes available, so the most obvious natural bluff candidate would be a combo that blocks the straight. However, as you may recall, the solver bet 100% of its straights on the turn, thus rendering the big blind straight blockers of little value. Right, if instead we lock the turn and force all of Limitless's straights to check and then recalculate the river, we see that the solver now begins to shove some of these 8x and 10x holdings that can bluff under the cover provided by the slow played straights in the big blind's range. And in turn, the prevalence of these additional natural bluffing combos provide cover for Limitless's stronger hands to also shove, such as his pocket sevens. That all being said, if we take a look at the EVs between raising 2/3 pot and shoving sevens in the original sim, we see that they're virtually identical. So either play should generally be okay from a GTO standpoint, especially when we consider the fact that Ben should have a number of weaker holdings here that can call a shove.
You'd expect him to keep barreling if he somehow bet a 9.
Wow.
If he had sevens, would he not bet bigger on the flop? If he had 2 pair, would he not bet bigger on the flop? He doesn't do this with anything but 4 houses, right?
Mm-hmm.
So now,
you're thinking about, yeah, what full house does he raise with pre like that, too? Is he raising jack 9? And you have a jack.
And if he does he not just continue to fire?
Right.
Does he bet so small on the flop? I mean, I was surprised he bet so small on the flop with a set. It's a really bizarre hand. And we're getting a treat here, guys. Today already in this tournament, we've had some really peculiar runouts in the no limit. And I honestly don't know what's right here for Ben. I mean, the only thing I will say is Ben can have plenty stronger, right? Ben can have a straight. Ben can have.
Ben mucks, and we see that the solver is primarily folding its top pairs facing this massive raise. Although the solver does show some frequency of calling with Jack 6 suited, we see that it is actually negative EV to call most of these top pairs, although it is plus EV to call Jack Deuce and Jack 7, obviously not because of the strength of the kicker since the kicker doesn't play, but rather because the Deuce and 7 block full houses in the big blind's range. And given that there aren't many natural bluffs in Limitless's range in this spot, there aren't many natural bluff catchers either, so it appears that the solver simply allocates some defense frequency across the class of hands that are near the bottom of its calling range. Although there is a flush draw on the board, given that the board is paired and Limitless checked on the turn, it becomes somewhat less likely that he shoved here with a flush draw, particularly since in Limitless's shoes, one of the worst bluff candidates in this spot would be a combo that blocks the missed flush draws in Ben's range. So in this hand, both players utilize solver-approved lines in a pot that initially had the potential to become huge. Although in hindsight, Limitless probably could have made more chips barreling three streets, by incorporating slow playing into his game, in the long run, he's able to disguise his play, which makes him much more difficult to exploit. So that's the video for today. Thanks for watching, and until next time, stay at home.